to the book of Psalms, chapter 15. Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? He that walketh uprightly, number one. He that worketh righteousness, number two. He that speaketh the truth in his heart, number three. He that sweareth to his own hurt and changeth not, number four, the last of verse four. He that putteth not his money to usury, nor taketh reward against the innocent, number five. He that doeth these things shall never be moved. From where? From thy tabernacle, from thy holy hill. Now, in contrast to this, we have been also looking at Psalm 24, and our introductory message was from this psalm. Verse 3 asks the question, who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? One, he that hath clean hands. Two, a pure heart. Three, who hath not lifted up his soul into vanity. And four, he who hath not sworn deceitfully. And you have been with us in this short introduction of the series, the first two messages, have seen that the emphasis is the contrast between ascending and abiding. In Psalm 24, the question is, who shall ascend? Lord, who's going to be able to come into your presence? Who's going to have the moment to stand? That momentary contact, that opportunity to have a crisis experience in you. And the answer is, the one who has had the sprinkling of the blood and the washing of the labor. The one who has appropriated grace to his life. God does for that individual everything necessary to enable him to ascend into the divine presence. But Psalm 15 asks, not Lord, who shall ascend, but Lord, who's going to abide. Not who shall stand, but Lord, who's going to be able to stay in your holy presence. And the answers are very diverse from the answers given to who can get there. God's glorious grace appropriated to your life will let you get into the presence of God for an experience. But it's going to take more than applied grace to remain there. It's going to take altered behavior to be able to remain in the presence of God. And so we're dealing with this altered behavior. Well, I think all of us are tired of the roller coaster. We're tired of having just that glorious Elam contact with God during camp meeting season, and then off the top of it, and within just weeks, and for some of us just days, to end the whole ride and be right back into the same old carnal way of life, looking forward to the next conference. One of the curses of the present charismatic move is that people travel thousands of miles, literally so, to get into conferences. And they have their glorious crisis touch with God, and then they go back to dead, dry, dull churches where there is no life and lose the whole thing. And they just live from peak to peak. Now, I'm not going to take those peaks away from them or they'd be dead. I don't want to take a crisis experience away from anyone. I'm not here to preach, come out from among them and join us, because we really don't have much to join. But I am saying things that God has something better than those momentary contacts, those high peaks, those conference encounters, those crisis experiences. God's goal is not that we have up and down experiences, but that we have continuous, progressive gradients that reach from you to God, and that everything we do, every step we take, lead us that much closer to an abiding presence. God wants you to live with him. God wants to abide in you. I haven't taken time to present what I think is obvious, that the New Testament's whole teaching is an abiding thing. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, Father, what you've done for me, I've done for them. What you've given to me, I've given to them. Father, I want them to be one in us as I am one in you. I and them, you and me, together. All the New Testament teaches, God's goal is that there be such an entwining in Jesus that we are in Christ, in Christ, in Christ. What is it? 106 times that shows up in the New Testament. In him, not touching him, not standing there, not just ascending there, but in him. Abiding, a constancy. And the work that God has been able to do in our world through men has been done by men who have learned how to get in Christ and stay there. Not by those who came into momentary contact, short-term power, skyrocketing sort of ministries, but men like Spurgeon, Finney, Moody, let's not go through a long list, men who learned to abide in him and let him abide in them. And I believe the prophetic utterance God gave earlier in this service was the cry of the Spirit that you and I shall make an adjustment of our behavior, that there can be a constancy. God wants a continuum of relationship. There's a work yet to be done that this nation hasn't seen, and it can be done only through channels who learn to abide in him. Amen? Now, the answer given by God to David's cry, Lord, who's going to be the one who's going to abide? Who's going to be the one that can just absolutely stay, dwell, sojourn, is the literal translation, in your presence, seems so normal, natural, almost earthy, that we can hardly accept it. We would expect God to deal with more spiritual things, like fasting for 40 days, praying 6 hours per day, joining a monastery, getting involved in some form of asceticism, or at least coming under eldership and submission, and all the women find their place and stay there and let the men trump them or whatever their views may be. But God deals with the things that affect your relationship to him. And the first thing is your walk. There has to be an altered walk. He that walketh uprightly. And we looked at that in some depth yesterday morning. God would have us to learn to walk in the Spirit so that we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Not only will not, but cannot fulfill the lust of the flesh. God would like to have us learn to walk in faith, not in fear. Because fear and faith are the same power running in opposite directions. God would like to have us learn to walk in love, not in lust. God would like to have us learn to walk in truth, not in error. God would like to have us learn to walk in the calling he gave and not start giving God the calling you want. And when a man can learn to walk in the Spirit and progressively walk in faith and love and truth while remaining in the calling God gave him, that man abides. That man has made adjustments that make abiding possible. And while it seems very earthy and down to order, and some have said, boy, this series is beginning to be corn, well, you can do better than this. The truth is, I can't. This is what God's talking to my heart about. And so it's going to be what God has to talk to your heart through me. We've got to learn to adjust our walk. And as we observed yesterday, it can't be a one-time adjustment. Every time I move my foot, I'm having to make an adjustment in my walk. Our blind brother, the piano, who sang for us a moment ago, amused all of us by saying that while his problem and persecution isn't basically from people, it's from dogs. He steps on them. Few of us would ever think of that problem because we've been sighted all our life. So he has to do a constant adjustment of his walk because he can't see. And I'm having to do a constant adjustment on my walk for most of the time in the spiritual, I can't see either. I'm walking, not in darkness, but I'm walking without sight. I'm walking a path I've not seen before. It's kind of like walking in the fog. I can see one step ahead of me, but that's all. And I'm having to walk cautiously, continuously, and carefully. Now this morning I wanted to look at the second adjustment that is required of us. Not only he that walketh uprightly, but he that worketh righteousness. Now, it's always dangerous to start talking about works. Because we can get into the extreme contrast. Those who say, bless God, it's going to be by works. And there are those who say, bless God, works are out, no works. The truth is, God's word commands us to work. But religion generally controls the nature of the work. Religion is the workingest organization there is. Somewhere along the line, we've got the concept that everyone should be doing something. And so every new convert has to be assigned a job that is nothing more than watering the flowers. You feel that it's spiritual to be doing something. Now, I believe that if we're spiritual, we'll be doing something. But doing something doesn't make us spiritual. And working for the sake of having a job isn't at all spiritual. So it is not just he that worketh, but he that worketh righteousness. And let's see if we can think in several different directions, but not concurrently, and see what the Spirit may be trying to teach us about working righteousness. I think the first is the most obvious. It certainly would not be working to try and produce righteousness. You cannot work up righteousness. The maximum you can do is work it out after it's been put in. Any system of work that attempts to produce righteousness, even produce righteous behavior, will bring you into condemnation and bondage. For Galatians 2:16 says, by the works of the flesh shall no man be justified. Underline it. Shall no man be justified. Now, I don't care if they are Episcopal works or Pentecostal works. If they are man's works, there is no way it can bring justification to you. I don't care whether you use grape juice or wine. I don't care whether you have pie socials or just have offering plates. I don't care whether you run around with tracts and do your best to get everybody converted or at least convinced, or whether all you have is prayer meetings. If the basis of what you're doing is a system devised by man, it can't produce any righteousness. And even if the system is devised of God, the system can't produce righteousness. Nothing you can do, capital N-O-T-H-I-N-G, underline, nothing you can do will produce righteousness. Not leading souls to Christ, not getting them filled with the Holy Spirit, not laying hands on the sick and seeing them recover, not playing the organ, singing solos, preaching sermons, building buildings, nothing you can do can produce righteousness. Nothing. That's on death again today. I know that from the ears up we give a sense to this. But think, it's awfully hard to get your spirit to believe this. Because we're forever wanting to make it up to God. To help him out. No one wants to be saved by grace through faith. Period. Well, after all, there's something I can do. And so we write a check. We volunteer to teach a class. We man the bus system. And all these things are right and proper and should be done. But if the reason we are doing them is to help produce some righteousness, we're doomed to condemnation. For until you can accept that righteousness is imputed from the cross of Jesus Christ to the confessed penitent, you'll never know righteousness. And any addendum you add to it takes away from instead of adds to. But that's obvious. Let's look at the less obvious. He that worketh righteousness. I think that it's concerned with works that are the outgrowth of our newfound relationship in the holy place. We've had that momentary confrontation that brought us in. We've at least been brought as far as the holy place, the golden candlestick, the golden table, the golden altar. We've had an opportunity to see something of the working of the Spirit, the fellowship of God and his people, and high-level praise. And now, from this experience, comes a desire to do. And if you want to, you may turn to 1 Corinthians 3, for I'd like to point out that in this one chapter, I see at least three levels of service. In verses 4 through 6, there seems to have been some contention, and Paul is trying to answer it by saying, while one saith I'm a Paul, another of Apollos, aren't you carnal? Who is Paul, and who is Apollos, but ministers by whom you believed, even as the Lord gave to every man? I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. And I would suggest this is at least illustrative, if not instructive, of the first level of service, whereby we do things for God. man was out there and he plowed that field for God. Another man came along and he planted it for God. And a third man watered it for God. And then God made it grow. Imagine this is where we all start in our service, doing things for God. It's outer court ministry. Everything done in the outer court was done for God, on God's behalf. It wasn't done by God, it was done for him, it was done by man. And all this working for God is usually a response to a precept. We see something in the Word, and we say, gonna do it. Go ye into all the world and make disciples of all the nations, teaching them to observe whatsoever I've commanded you. I see it, I'll do it. And in response to that precept, we become a missionary, or we are missionarily oriented. God said it, and we do it. Now, this is not wrong. At least it's a start. At least we have some motion. One of its good points is that at least it has produced obedience. And that's better than sacrifice. But its weaknesses are twofold. First of all, it tends to be very need-oriented. It's interesting that we rarely see the command until we have seen the need. And then having seen the need, we find the command, and we put the command and the need together, and wham, bam, away we go. And I want you to know that Jesus Christ refused to be need-oriented. He was voice-controlled. He said, the works that I do are the works I see my Father do. The words that I speak are the words I hear my Father speak. It's not my will, but his. If Jesus had been need-oriented, he would never have gone to the pool of Bethesda, chose the one man the Father had chosen, healed him, and let him off without healing anyone else. We all know that Jesus had the power to heal everyone at the pool. We can also presuppose that after having healed the man who had seniority right there, 38 years, he surely was chairman of the board by that time, and who's more bored than those sitting around waiting to get healed, surely everybody said, me too, Jesus, and Jesus walked right on through them. He didn't always feed the multitude. He didn't always heal all the people. He didn't always minister to all the needs. Because Jesus was not need-oriented. He didn't come to alleviate human suffering. He came to reveal the Father. And if meeting a need would reveal the Father, he'd meet the need. But if meeting a need would hinder revelation of the Father, he'd walk right on by. Saying to the disciples, you can have the poor with you always. You'll always have needs. I haven't sent you here to destroy yourself trying to meet needs. I sent you here to reveal the Father. More preachers have been exhausted before their time and are in nervous tension because they are need-oriented. You don't have to have a big church to be exhausted by needs. All you need to have is two or three mouthy people with telephones. The second level of service I find in verse 9. For we are laborers together with God. In 2 Corinthians 6:1, it says we are workers together with God. Laborers together with, workers together with. Now this is superior than doing for. You need a job. You apply, you're hired. Which would you prefer? Have the boss give you a book and say, all right, here's the instructions, here's the way we want to do it, there's the machine, go to it. Do it for me. Or say, fine, join me. You'll learn as we go along. Get in the truck. We'll go out to the first job now. And give you on-the-job training so that you aren't doing things for him, you're doing things with him. Assuming him to be an acceptable gentleman, we'd much prefer to work with the boss than work for him. Why then do so many Christians prefer to take the book, choose the orders that they will obey, and run around condemning everyone who doesn't do what they do and obey as they obey, because that's the third weakness of that first level of service. It tends to become very legalistic. Anyone who isn't doing it my way, down the tube with them, they're not of God. But when you start working with him, You're no longer working in outer court ministry, you're working in inner court ministry. That's where the candlestick is, the table, the altar of incense. We're doing things with God. And one day Jesus was at a very active religious gathering. Even Old Testament religious gatherings were exhausted. And seeing the weariness of the people who had been drawing water and pouring it and killing calves and pouring out blood and sprinkling and all that goes with these big tent meeting things, Jesus said, "Come unto me, all ye that are weary, heavy laden. I'll give you rest." Well, what a way to get a crowd. Just show up at a conference and then say, "If you're worn out, come here and I'll give you rest." People would stand in line 3 hours after you lay hands on them if you would tell them, "I'll give you rest." But his next statement almost belies the first. "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly of heart, and you shall find rest for your souls." Now, wait a minute. I came because I want rest. You said I shall find rest, but how can I ever have rest with my neck in a yoke? Because yokes are for working, not for resting. I'll tell you how. Nowhere in the Bible is rest to be equated with inactivity. Rest in the scripture is equated with directed activity. And when the Lord invites you to put your neck in his yoke, your activity is going to be directed. You're going to learn of him, not about him. You're going to learn standing with him. The first lesson you'll learn is that the yoke's too big. And you're going to have to stand on tiptoe just to hold your end up. Remember who the partner is? Jesus. The second thing you're going to learn is that when he goes forward, you better go with him or you're going to get a plow right up your spine. Because when he moves, things move. Everything attached to him moves. The third thing you're going to learn is that when he stops, you better stop. Because all you're going to do is get sore shoulder muscles trying to go when he isn't. A fourth thing you're going to learn is you better eat when he eats, because that's the only time the yoke will lower to the grass. And you better drink when he drinks, because you can never force his neck down when you're thirsty. You better drink when he's thirsty. Do you understand what I'm saying? How many of us have learned that when the Spirit wants to pray is the time to pray? When the Spirit wants to read, that's the time to read. And all I have to do is set up a schedule, and I find out he isn't on the same schedule, and he isn't even on the same time zone I'm on. From 9 to 10 is going to be time on my knees to pray. More than likely, he'll wake me up at 5 and say, "I want to pray now." Now, if I say, "I said 9, he goes ahead and prays at 5. I sleep. For the Holy Spirit doesn't need my help to pray. You know that. I need his. He doesn't need mine. But when I try to pray at 9 o'clock, it's so hard because he's busy and the yoke is up here and moving. And this, you just can't get quiet. God's got you busy. Still, another thing you learn is that when he turns, you better turn or you're going to get a terrible creak in your neck. An even greater lesson you'll learn is to pull the instrument he's fixed to, not the instrument you were a specialist in. Oh, how much damage has done on the work of the Lord because we refuse to get fixed to anything but our specialty. So here's a man who is really a specialist in pulling a plow. And he shows up in a harvest field and plows under a year's labor. I've seen time for the ingathering toward the close of the message totally ruined by someone who wasn't yoked to Christ, thinking this is the time for a run up and down the center aisle with 3 hallelujahs and 2 praise the Lord. We need to be yoked with him. He knows when it's time to plow. He knows when it's time to dig. He knows when it's time to fertilize. He knows when it's time to plant. He knows exactly what instrument to use. We don't. We're beginning to learn a little bit about this, Brother George, in our plurality of eldership. We are, have predetermined who's supposed to preach or who we think is supposed to preach. But it's not at all infrequent, just as that brother gets ready to preach, for the Lord to give something to another. And it turns out that that's the one the Lord intends to use. And we've learned not to feel, hey, I'm getting cheated, he got to preach last week. Let the Lord choose whom he will, because we're very diverse. Each of us has a different ministry. And in fairness, we predetermine and we gather together for prayer before the service and say, does anyone feel he has something? Often we don't, but as the service progresses, we'll find God do it. I've had the occasion where I was into my sermon 10 minutes, and one of the brothers stand and say, just a minute, if you don't mind, Brother Cornwall, I wonder if you've ever noticed, and take what I've already said and twist it 90 degrees and move out and do a work I'd have never gotten done. God wanted to use that instrument. Now, you're going to learn of the Lord if you get yoked with him. You'll learn his pace, and you'll learn that he doesn't walk always. He rests. And you'll find now that you are responding not to a precept, but to a partner. And you'll be as comfortable in not doing as you are comfortable in doing, as long as the partner isn't doing anything. Now, if I am only responding to a precept, I'm always uncomfortable. If I'm doing, I'm not doing enough. If I'm not doing, I've got 3 black marks against me already. But when I am working just as the fellow in the yoke, the responsibility is his. He is the trained burden bearer, and I am the learner. I am the apprentice. I am the trainee. Then all responsibility is his. If he doesn't move, there's no guilt if there's no movement on my part. If he turns left when it would appear we should go right, no guilt. The responsibility is his. He is training, and I am learning. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. I believe very definitely in discipleship. But I believe that we should be disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ more than disciples of men. Now, I'm not anti-aiding one another. You understand that. Teaching and sharing and pastoring, etc. Listen, I don't want people in yokes with me. I get long-distance phone calls whenever I'm home. When I get back, there'll be a stack of mail there. A percentage of the mail will be people wanting to come and be discipled by me. No way. Come, be pestered by me and afflicted by me, but I'm not going to take on the responsibility of discipling people. I think that responsibility is between you and the Lord. I will teach, I will train, I will assist, I will do all I can as elder or pastor in ministry, but I don't want you yoked to me. The last thing America needs is anybody else like me. But the whole world needs a few more people like Jesus. Philippians 2, 12 and 13 tell us, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. I'm not a Greek scholar. I was exposed to it, but it didn't take. Weiss is a Greek scholar, I was, and I bought his book. And he says that the Greek here is calling for us to work out as one does when working out a problem of mathematics. That is, the problem is before you. Now you carry it out to its ultimate conclusion. Do the multiplication, the division, the subtraction, the addition, so that finally all factors are worked out and you end up with the proper sum. Now God has put within you righteousness. He says, now work it out in the everyday nitty-gritty of life. Where there needs to be a multiplying, do it. Where there needs to be some dividing, divide. Where there needs to be some subtracting, remove. Where there needs to be some adding, put in. But keep working on the problem until you get a solution. Now, I find quite the opposite current. If at first you don't succeed, give up. Or call up somebody who can cast it out of you. Or show up where somebody can lay hands upon you. Now, when Paul was with saints at Philippi, his teaching instructed them. And his example inspired them. And his encouragement urged them on, but he says, I'm not there now. You'll have to do your own teaching. You'll have to find your own inspiration. And you're going to have to do your own urging to an ultimate conclusion. For God, who has begun a good work within you, wants to complete it under the day of Christ. He'll complete his end, but get busy with your end. Paul speaks of putting off, mortifying, shunning, forsaking, ceasing. He talks about putting on, adding, embracing, reckoning. All of these are acts we get involved in. It's not done for us, it's done by us. It was given to us. All the factors of the problem are put within us. Grace has come. But since grace needs to be applied, it needs to be worked out in our everyday behavior pattern. And if we would learn to abide rather than just ascend in the presence of God, we're going to have to learn to constantly apply the word of God to our behavior pattern. We're going to have to learn to work our work to produce divine image within it. Now, I'm not asking you to do it without the help of the Spirit, but I'm just telling you that the Spirit will not do it without the help of you. Until there is a submitting of your will, and we'll be looking at that theme, what, 2 mornings? Perhaps it'll take us 2 mornings to handle it, too. But until there is a submitting of your will and an activation of your life, there's very, very little the Spirit can do after he saves you and fills you with the Holy Spirit. And we love to take those two crises experience and we say, hallelujah, it's all right. Yes, all that can ever be done to save you as far as rescuing you from hell and assuring you opportunity for heaven has been done. That was done at Calvary. But think, what needs to be done to change you from a baby to an adult man is going to require an awful lot of work on your part. You're going to have to eat and sleep and exercise and learn and try and fail and try and learn and try and mess it up and keep working at it until you get this thing worked out. The two happiest times of a pastor's life, or at least in my life as a pastor, was marrying the couple and dedicating the baby. I guess I'm just a sucker for a pretty woman, and a woman is never prettier than those two times in her life. But when that young couple stands before me taking the vows, become husband and wife, oh, the happiness, and they just exude their love, and they tell everyone how great it is, and the first few weeks, they tell everyone it's the greatest marriage, ours is the absolute perfect marriage, hallelujah. No problem. We are blended together. God did it. All right. Wait a while. What God did was put factors in you. 30 years later, you may have the problem worked out. We just had our 32nd anniversary. We're still working on some of those factors. You're a lot better than it used to be. Probably not as good as it's going to get, but it's marvelous. But the only hope for a marriage to succeed is not to believe that the preacher can magically make you a husband and a wife. He can only legally give you a chance to try to become husband and wife. And it's going to take a lot of doing, a lot of living, a lot of understanding, a lot of working together, occasional sparks. I've even seen a few occasions where it produced a flame. And sometimes, you know, boy. Now, the same principle is here. You, in a relationship with God, in every Bible division, is called husband-wife. God is bringing you into a whole new realm of living, and one of the two of you is going to have to change and adapt to make it work. And unfortunately, the Bible says, and written by God, God changes not. So if you're going to make this marriage with God work, you're going to have to do the changing. And so he gives you the factors. He gives you the motivation. He so fills you with love, you want to change to be what he wants. But all of his gifts and all of your desires do not produce the change. You must produce the change. You must do the adjusting. You must work out the righteousness. Now, I don't mean do religious work. I mean let the righteousness of God work in you effectually, right? Give it a chance. And give it some help. I guess all I'm trying to say is what was conferred upon you must be consummated by you. Could we handle one more concept? He that worketh righteousness shall never be moved. I would suggest we're going to have to get involved in the works of God, not the works of man. Turn with me to John's Gospel, chapter 6. I want to read with you verses 28 and 29. Jesus has given a fabulous discourse to these people. Fed the 5,000, gave them the discourse on the bread of life. And finally he gets a response from them, and they said unto him, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? Jesus answered and said unto them, this is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he hath sent. The work of God is to believe? Right. I thought the work of God was to feed the poor, help the distressed, give second-hand clothes to missionary barrels, send you tea bags to Africa. No. Jesus broke it down to its elementary factor and said, this is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he hath sent. Now Vincent, speaking of the Greek structure here, says that faith here is put as a moral act or a work. And it's peculiar, for we don't generally think of faith as an act or a work. We think of it as a sensation or a concept. But through the Bible, faith is not put as a concept. Faith is put as a force at work. For instance, 1 Thessalonians 1:3 calls it the work of faith. Now, when we hear the expression, faith works, we often equate that to me. If I have faith, I get what I want. But that isn't what the Bible says. And that isn't what those words mean. Faith works. Faith is a laborer. Faith gets involved in doing something. Hebrews 11:6 reminds us, without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is the rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Without faith, there's no hope of pleasing God. So, the first step in doing the works of God is to start letting your faith work. Getting it active. How many times have you met the person who will declare, I have all the faith in the world, but you don't need all the faith in the world. If you get your faith working, mustard seed size will do most of the acts you need done. But while we're building storehouses to hold all the faith in the world, like Fort Knox holding the gold, God's trying to find somebody who will let living faith begin to work and produce and get applied. Let your faith work! Faith works. Feelings are so vacillating. Concepts become so passive, but faith is always active. You cannot be a man of faith and be inactive, because faith will work. And faith will work you. My Lord, you can be worked right into the ground with just two mustard seed sizes of faith. I don't think you're understanding this, because I'm not saying it wisely. He that cometh unto God must believe that he is. Of course you believe that God is. But is what? Is the rewarder of them that diligently seek him. My faith in what God is determines whether I shall simply have a momentary standing in his presence or a staying in his presence. God isn't what he preached to be. God is who he says he is. God isn't necessarily what your concepts are. God is what his word says he is. And I have found it necessary to have a change in concept every time God has lifted me to a higher level of abiding in him. Now, the concepts I was given were not necessarily erroneous, but they were low level, early beginning concepts. And I've had to have enlarged concepts of my God. It's only as I see him more as he is that I can abide in his presence. I need to know him as he is. Now, some of us had some rather weird concepts. If you're raised under extreme legalism as I was, then you had a God with a club in one hand, a whip in the other, seven recording angels giving you black marks, and you were forever trying to earn brownie buttons, two brownie buttons, so you erase one black mark, and you know how the game went. And he was the policeman. If mother couldn't threaten you into obedience with a cop, she'd threaten you into obedience with God. And then I was told, let's stand and praise God. Yeah? Who praises a cop? Especially after he's pulled you over for speeding. Great to see you, man! So I had to find out that God wasn't a traffic cop. Interestingly enough, I found out the Holy Spirit is, and I was never afraid of the Holy Spirit, was afraid of God. The Holy Spirit convinces of sin. I need to know who God is. And I learn who God is by putting my faith to work. Well, the Bible gives us all the facts we need about God. Plenty of the facts won't do you much good. Facts without faith produce books and theology, but not relationships. My wife and I courted during our Bible school days. It was a no-no, but it was a lot of fun. She kept writing home about this wonderful young man she met. Finally went home to let the family know that I had finally got up enough nerve to ask her to marry me, and she had thought it over for 14, 15 seconds and said yes. And her father, a wise old farmer, said, "You know anything about the man?" "Oh, yeah. Yes, Daddy." "Well, tell me." So she told him what size hat I wore. See how old I am? We wore hats back then. My shirt size, my shoe size, the songs I like to sing, the fact that I played a little piano in Oregon, and that I was a preacher, and he said, "Is that all?" He said, "Well, yes, I guess so, Dad, but you don't know the man. After you've been married to him 10 years, you may know him. Right now, he's a stranger. Do you want to risk your life with a stranger?" For my sake, I'm glad that she did. But isn't it true? You can know all about a person's size and visions and goals and capacities and capabilities and not know them. And faith has to cause you to embrace God as a pretty much an unknown quantity. Oh, you know his hat size. You know all these things about him, all the things the Bible says. But you don't know him until by faith you dare commend your life to him and say, "I'll take your name, I'll trust your nature, and I am yours." And then in that interpersonal reaction and action, you begin to come to know your God, and you find yourself being able to really believe on him. And this makes it possible for you to abide in his presence, because no more fear, faith is at work. And you can stand in his presence. "Well, I wouldn't be afraid of God." You're the only one in the building. The rest of us are. No way. Huh? How about the children of Israel? They saw all these might, power, miracles, drank supernatural water, ate supernatural bread. And after all God did to prove who he was, he talked to them and said 10 sentences, and they said, "Don't ever talk to us again," to the elders of Moses. "Go tell God, don't ever talk to us again." Deuteronomy chapter 6. "We can't stand this. No man can listen to God and live." Tell God to write it down. We can read, but we can't listen.
They were terrorized.
You may feel a bit smug, you have no problem with God. But I tell you in all honesty, if God were to come in here with his presence, one third as real as on that mountain, we would make new doors out these walls. I don't mean that unkindly, but I mean it. We're only comfortable with God up to the limit of our concept, up to the limit of our faith. And God is saying, oh, enlarge your faith, enlarge your concept, so I can come along you in a renewed major, in an enlarged major. Before my heart attack, I had a series on the tabernacle I was preaching. I'm trying now to write it in a book. Very, very consistent. Every chapter has been rejected except one, the introduction. All right, if Logos will accept the introduction, I'll eventually find out how to write the book so it'll accept the chapters. But my projection of the tabernacle is how to approach God. Why you have to come by the seven stations, and what each one does to change you so you can stand in the presence of God. And it was very real to me at the time I was teaching the series. I taught it in four places, and then I stopped teaching it. I don't know that I will ever teach it again because of the reaction. On every occasion, when I would bring them to step through the veil, to come into the realized presence of God, without exception, one or more people would stand and scream and run down the center aisle, and no one ever made the door. They always ran into a wall. On one occasion, we had to call an ambulance to send them to the hospital. It was that severe. And all I was doing was verbally dramatizing what it was like for the high priest to do it. What would it be like if actually we did step through the veil into the holies of holies? Well, unless there had been some workings of faith within us to where we could handle God as he really is, we dropped. Maybe only under the power, and maybe rather permanently. So God says, hey, the works of God is that you learn how to believe in him whom he has sent. And when we get to know him as he is, we can see him as he is, and we can be where he is. Amen? You're true, and I'm not. That's a bad situation, but I have to honor you. I would have gone one more direction, and I just simply say it to you, that we must learn to get involved in works of love, not of duty. And I would have reminded you of the little story over in Mark 14, where Lazarus, having been raised from the dead, has a big banquet thrown for him. And Jesus was also invited. That always breaks me up when I do that. Lazarus gets the place of honor. Jesus, who did the whole thing, is way down the row. But that's not too difficult. We still do the same thing. We give more honor to the person in whom the miracle was wrought than the Christ who did the miracle working. Mary couldn't handle it. She looked through the window, saw what was happening, said, he's got to be honored. Went to her home and got the box of spikenard, very costly, which is either laid up toward a dowry for her marriage, or if that fails, for her burial. Her whole savings account, and came in and risked the ridicule of the men, violating the basic premise that no woman comes into the feast of men, and broke the box and poured it over the head of Jesus, down his beard, and caught it, took it down to his feet, and then wept on his feet, and let her hair down, and began to wipe up. She loved Jesus. It wasn't a duty. It was the host's duty to wash his feet. But the host was so excited with Lazarus, he forgot Jesus. So she came in, not out of duty, but out of love. And she took all the ridicule, all the cost, just to pour her love upon Jesus. Judas felt it should have gone to the poor, probably meaning poor Judas. The disciples ridiculed her, and Jesus said, let her alone. She has wrought a good work on me. Everywhere the gospel preached, this act is going to be mentioned. Why? Because she had learned a work of love. Oh, what a difference when I'm working out of duty and when I'm working out of love. What a difference when I preach because I'm under contract to preach
And when I preach, because I've had a fresh touch with Jesus, and I'm just loving him and enjoying teaching his kids for him. Huh? Works of love. All saints will work harder, longer, and do more for love than for anything else. Now, most men aren't too good at communicating with women. But all of us were smart enough not to approach that young lady upon whom we'd set our gaze and say, Eleanor, I don't quite know how to say it, but you know, I'm going to be a busy man, and I'm going to need a housekeeper. And I'm going to need somebody to kind of help manage my money and balance the checking accounts and see that the car is greased and filled with gasoline and tires are changed. And I don't know, you know, I might get to the place where my ego needs to have a miniature me, and I'm wondering if you would be willing to be the womb in which I could have a child gestated with my nature. And, you know, I'd like a good cook. I wonder if you would consider living with me. Any fellow that makes that approach is going to lose. What do we fellows do? Oh, we start talking to her about sinking in our arms, knowing that if she will, she'll eventually have her arms in our sink. And what ways do we offer her? I love you. I love you. And the man who knows women, or knows his woman, will constantly pour love on her, and she won't ask for anything else. If you'll love her, she'll scrub your floor, bear your babies, take care of your car, balance your checking account. If things get rough, go out and take a part-time job to help out financially. She'll work like a fool. If you love her, you start loving her, and she's going to growl and complain about everything. She'll go on strike. The house will be a mess. The clothes won't be done. You'll eat TV dinner. When I see a woman who is loved, and I see her finding fulfillment in her house, her chore, her home, her children. The other day, my wife and I have been extremely busy the last few days preparing for our daughter to come. More details than you need to know, but just long hours from 6 in the morning till midnight or 1 o'clock. And we laid down, and she says, "Honey, you're leaving tomorrow." I said, "Yes, sorry, I'll be gone for 5 weeks. She says, "Honey, I haven't told you I loved you for days." I said, "Oh, yes, you have." She says, "Have I? I don't remember." "See, you don't? You have run errands for me for the things I needed. You have fed me excellent meals. You brought iced tea out to me when I was working on her car. You've just done all kinds of things. You've washed all my clothes. You've seen that my suits were clean. You've helped me pack. And you say you haven't said I love you, honey. You've said I love you from 6 in the morning till midnight." Because that's the response of love, to do what helps the loved one. When a person learns to be a lover with the Lord, he'll never be inactive. He'll almost become hyperactive. His attitude is, "What would you like to have done? What can I do for the Lord? Can I make him a cake? Can I clean his floor? Can I fix? Got any clean water? What can I do for the Lord?" You'll find that all through the Bible, men who touch God, women who touch God, the cry of their heart is, "What can I do for the Lord?" This is the working of righteousness. It's no longer a duty. "After all he's done for me, how can I do less than give him my best and live for him completely? After all he's done for me." Knock it off. That's religion. He doesn't want people doing out of duty. He's no longer screaming from the sky, 10 commandments, do it and live, disobey it and die. What he is saying is, "I love you. Will you love me?" And when we come into that love relationship, we tend his children, we feed his sheep, we tend his church, we drive his buses, we do anything that needs to be done, and never realize we're working. We're loving. We're loving. Oh, let's learn to work out of love motivation, and we'll be able to stand in his presence. Amen?